here at an interesting location for this interview, saying hello to director Jon Schnepp and Holly Payne. How are you?
Hey, what's going on?
We're here to talk about your movie, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened. Now, before we get into that, you've had three different location changes today, where they had you on the floor, then they had you at one bar, then they had you at another bar. Now we're out on the balcony overlooking the bay here in San Diego.
We weren't aware of any of that. We were just told to come here, so... Yeah.
Whatever location problems you had didn't affect us at all. We've been here the whole time.
Oh, then that's something I had to deal with then.
I'm sorry.
So we're sitting out here on the balcony, and we want to talk about this
movie.
Wait,
sorry, we're going to change locations. Is that going to bum you out?
Sure, I'll just hit pause and see you in 4 hours. Let's talk about the movie here. First of all, this project got started through Kickstarter, and
that's
it's one of the success stories of Kickstarter.
Right,
a lot of people put stuff out there through Kickstarter and other fund me projects, and some have great concepts, some are ridiculous, and then some just don't get the funding that they need to make their stuff, and then some do, and then it doesn't go anywhere, like Veronica Mars.
Right.
But this one is a little different. There was actually a lot of enthusiasm for such a niche topic.
I know. Well, I look at it this way, like doing something on Kickstarter is, to me, it is a niche group of people that you can directly connect with.
Yeah.
And I always trust my gut on projects, anything that I do professionally or even creatively, I trust myself. And because the reason I trust myself as a dyed-in-the-wool nerd is I know that if it's something that interests me, I think that there's at least a million other nerds who are interested as much as I am. And if I can connect with them and communicate with them, then they're going to want to see what I'm going to make because it's something that I want to see. So by doing that kind of process in my mind, I never second-guess myself. I trust my gut. And then this idea for doing a documentary on the Superman Lives really just came from my interest in the artwork and trying to find out if there was more artwork and why this fell apart, because it had so many things in my mind going for it. It had a great, amazing director, Tim Burton. It had interesting scripts written by Kevin Smith, Wesley Strick, Dan Gilroy. It had Nicolas Cage as Superman, which was an inspired casting choice. Had a lot of different things going for it, and it fell apart. So seeing all the artwork, it really interested me. And then over the years, kind of trying to find more about it over the years on the internet, is just ultimately I ran into Steve Johnson back in 2012 at one of these shows that we were at. And then I talked with Holly and a bunch of our friends at dinner and told them all my interest of collecting, you know, this behind-the-scenes footage and just my interest in the Superman Lives project. And everyone there at the table was like, wow, that's you really into it. And the way you told it, it sounds really interesting. You should make a documentary. I said, I don't make documentaries. They said, you should do it on Kickstarter, because the year before I had raised $175,000 to make a short animated short. So I'd already done a really successful Kickstarter. So they're like, why don't you do another Kickstarter? I was like, nah, I don't want to do it, a documentary. The idea would not leave me alone. I was like, no one else is going to make this. I realized that, you know, I'm in my own mind, I was like, no one will make this. That people have talked about making it, but no one in certain terms has the fucking guts to make it, because it's such a weird concept. Anybody I told about it, they were like, yeah, well, you know, it's definitely weird. You're going to make a documentary. It's a career suicide in a certain sense, because known as a director of cartoons and TV shows, and here I am trying to make a documentary about a failed thing from 15 years ago. People thought it was crazy. So I ran the Kickstarter. It was a success. I thought I could do it in a lot sooner, quicker amount of time, because doing television production, you slate everything out. The one thing I didn't count on is being powerless, because you're not hiring people to work with you. You're asking real people to be involved in your documentary and have them be interviewed. And some of the people didn't want to talk. Some of the people felt weird about it. Some of the people felt embarrassed about it.
Even when we went, we were at a D. Antwoord show, actually. It was at Meltdown Comics, and that's where John saw Steve Johnson, who's the creator of Slimer, and worked on Videodrome and a bunch of other. He's amazing. He's a master, you know, master special effects guru. And even when John went up to talk to him, you know, he was the guy who created that, you know, infamous rainbow light-up Superman suit. And he was gun-shy. He was like, so, because John was like, you're the guy who did that suit, right? And he's like, yeah. But you know, so it was like one of those things where, you know, there was
very hesitant, like, why? What are you going to tell me next?
What's up your sleeve?
At first, we were like, we got introduced by another nerd who was like, yo, this is the guy who directs Metalocalypse. This is the guy who created Slimer. You guys got to meet. So we were nerding out about a bunch of different stuff. And then he left, and I was like, man, the dude looks really familiar. And then I Googled his name, and that Superman footage popped up. I was like, of course. So when he came back, I was like, hey, man, you made that Superman suit. And he just turned white. Like, the whole approach, like, we weren't cool anymore. It's like, yeah, I made that. Yeah, he didn't want to talk about it. So that's what we were talking about at the dinner table. Like, it was a weird thing that so many people felt embarrassed or ashamed for being involved in a project that everybody makes fun of. Look at Nicolas Cage. You look stupid. This and that.
It had been so derided for so many years at that point. I mean, it's nearly 20 years. And so it was like a long time of people looking at that Polaroid of Nicolas Cage and saying, and that shiny suit, which looked like an action figure. I mean, I remember seeing that photograph many years ago and thinking, I think they photoshopped Nicolas Cage's head on top of an action figure. It didn't look real. Right. And then to find, actually, we didn't know that it wasn't until we saw we had access to all the concept art and the photos and all that stuff. So I was blown away when I saw that. I was like, wow, that's crazy. But there was so much negativity circulating around Superman Lives for so many years that I think people were, you know, it's like, well, you're opening Pandora's box. Do you really want to get into this, you know?
And I was like, let's open that box. Because honestly, like, you know, have you seen the film yet?
No, I have not seen the film yet.
I'd love to hear your opinion once you see it, but it's like a lot of people always use that we dodged a bullet, but because of that photo or because of the Kevin Smith story. But then when, upon further exploration, I think we missed a movie that would have become a classic, I think, because the perspective of taking someone like Tim Burton at the height of his career in many ways and taking Nicolas Cage also in many ways at the height of his career, just coming off of winning an Oscar, doing The Rock, doing Con Air, being at the height of being a popular actor and out of the niche roles that he was known for. You have all these people, all these amazingly talented people, all at the heights of their careers in many ways, being involved in a character that's been around at that time. It's 60 years the character had been around. So this was a different take on that character, and it was a way to breathe new life into that character. And movies in many ways are... movies based on comic book characters are just, to me, like an Elseworlds is the way I describe it. It's not a real... It's like you shouldn't be afraid of taking chances with a movie. This is when you can take chances. Right. You can explore it in a different direction. Comic books are so niche. It's like you should be trying to expand it to a larger marketplace. People always forget that movies are entertainment. So that's one of the reasons the film got
people
pulled.
Take it very personally.
I know. They take it, especially comic
fans. They have no involvement other than either you like the particular character, franchise, or I buy the merchandise. But that's about as far as you go, as far as what your investment is on those properties. Now, you, Holly had mentioned earlier all the negativity that was surrounding that movie at the time. The movie was supposed to be, what, like 98, somewhere around there, right?
Yeah.
So let's go back to right before all the negativity is hitting there. It's coming in a time where superhero movies are starting to break through in the 90s, but also falling back a little bit because of the Batman sequels weren't doing well and became campy and parodies of themselves. Right. And I guess by the fourth one, they were aware that they were campy parodies and started to play into that, and then it just kind of killed the whole thing for the movie companies.
Basically became was garbage.
Right.
I mean, it's like what you had were a lot of attempts by people who didn't really understand how to communicate comics to film. So you had attempts like the
Phantom.
Made
it very cartoony. Yeah.
Phantom or The Shadow or The Mask. There's all these. I mean, like, granted, like The Mask as a film, is it very entertaining?
I mean, even if you look at the colors are so garish. Everything's like straight directly from the page of comic books. They're going for, you know, the Dick Tracy bright yellows and greens and The Mask and all of these things that were so, it's like you can see where they were going, and Batman was a success, you know, but at the same time
ultimately it's like they couldn't sell Happy Meals. That's why Tim Burton's Batman Returns was too dark and strange for the studios, because they're like kids
are beloved by the audience and the fans of Batman.
Pretty much. I mean, it was like, well, look, kids are crying about the penguin with the weird flippers when they bought the Happy Meal.
And so biting the blood and everything.
So it was a little too dark at that time, and now we like fully accept dark superhero movies. We're like, look at Kick-Ass,
get darker.
Look at the Dark Knight with the Joker's interpretation that Heath Ledger and Christopher Nolan and David Goyer were able to pull off, one of the most striking and horrifying versions of the Joker ever. And even then, fans were fucking hating on it. Heath Ledger as the Joker, this horrible casting. Why don't you fucking relax and wait till the movie comes out? That's my opinion, period, on anything, especially Ben Affleck as Batman. It's like, look, it's different. And also, didn't the guy just do The Town, which is an incredible film? It's not the same thing as Daredevil, but people don't even think about that. They don't think about, like, well, the guy who wrote and directed Daredevil is a different person than the person who's making this other film.
I'll tell you where Strike 2 is on that, and not from me, but just from, you know, the people online and fans who just want to judge quickly before they actually see the context of anything. One, yes, Ben Affleck's cast in there, everyone's going, what the fuck, this is horrible. Number two, the teaser comes out, Superman, it's dark, he's up in the sky, it's raining, it cuts to Batman, he's got glowing eyes, and everyone just is like, what the fuck is this? They're going back to cartoony shit right. again, and you know that's why
haters gonna hate.
They're gonna hate.
Haters gonna hate, and here's the thing I wanted to mention too is the same thing goes for our film. You know, people are like they're gearing up to hate on maybe not the documentary, but anything to do with Superman Lives because of that negativity we were talking about earlier.
Well, let me ask you about you spoke with Tim Burton about all of this here. Now, Tim Burton's now coming back in 98 at this time to take the reins of Superman. He kind of successfully brought back the comic book movie by doing Batman and Batman Returns and gave it the start that it needed for others to do it, and everyone else kind of dropped the ball.
Right.
Now he's coming back to the superhero genre to take on Superman at the time.
Yeah.
Was he nervous and worried because of all the flack that the Batman movies were getting around that time that he's coming back into that genre to try to save it again?
Well, you know what's interesting? What you're saying is, I mean, there's elements of truth to it because like when he did the Batman film, The cinematic world of Batman to the rest of the general public, they only saw Adam West. Like, we as comic book nerds had already read The Dark Knight. We're like, you don't understand. Frank Miller's Batman. Then did you read Year One? That's such a tiny microcosm of the rest of the planet.
Right.
Everyone else was like, oh, Adam West, yeah, he's climbing up the side of the building with, ah, ha, ha, the Joker's got a mustache. You know, it's all funny, ha, ha. That's the perception of the general public until Batman came out. And so you watch Batman now, it's a lot different. But, you know, back then, that was like, that blew everyone away.
No, that was game-changing.
One of the things that's in the doc, you'll hear Wesley Strick, who was the second screenwriter, to talk about it. He said, talking to Tim about making superhero films, that Tim described it as Chinese water torture. And the reason that he wanted to make Batman 2, which is what it was called at the time, he said he'd learned things on the first one that he wanted to sort of do better in the second one, and I think the same thing could be said for Superman. For Superman Lives, I think he was still trying to break in, get his stamp on that, and no matter what, if it was a superhero film or anything else, he wants to put his own flavor on it. But the fact that it was, you know, Superman and not Batman meant he could actually do things that he could never have done in Batman and go lighter, you know?
Right.
Yeah, a lot of people think that Tim Burton's take on Superman would have been like some goth, freakish thing. It was like dark, spooky Edward Scissorhands Superman. It was, you know, those pictures that are out
right.
there, that was the regeneration suit. The actual Superman suit was exactly what you think it would be. And the film itself, the artwork and the concept designs that were like from Metropolis, and they were like lighter tone. It was like, would have been an airier type of brighter, almost like a fairy tale type film. And so it would have had that sense of humor that Mars Attacks had. It wouldn't have been dark and grim like Man of Steel. So it was definitely that people were really freaked out by Batman and Robin. So I think because his name is on there as a producer, that also helped tank Superman Lives.
Last question before you guys go here. Is Superman savable? Because say Superman Lives did get made and come out, it might have been fine, I guess, for the time, even
right.
though the hate was all around it.
Right.
But I don't know if that particular vehicle had enough power to jumpstart the Superman franchise again. And then it would take a while until Superman Returns came out. And
right.
despite the plane scene in the stadium, the rest of the movie was kind of garbage.
Right. And that plane scene in the stadium was actually from J.J. Abrams' script.
Right. So that didn't do anything. And then Man of Steel comes out, which, by the way, the beginning of it, on Krypton, all I kept seeing is his father. He looked like Man-at-Arms from He-Man. So it kind of took me out of the movie there.
Right.
But even though they were going in a serious route, a darker route, and people were dying in the Superman movie, he didn't save everybody because
yeah.
he was fighting and stuff like that. And that got criticism because
yeah.
everyone's like, oh, he's too clean cut and whatever. I want to see some, you know, some blood on his hands. Now you get it, and they're complaining about that.
I loved Man of Steel. And I defend that film to anyone who's like, all this, he didn't save anybody then. I'm like, guess what? He'd only been Superman for like one day.
Right.
And then he's Superman for one day. He just learns to fly, and then 100 other versions of him from Krypton show up, and they're all villains. They're from prison, and they're out there to get him and exact revenge on his father putting him in the Phantom Zone. So of course he doesn't know how to fight. We don't know what exactly happened when he was like getting trained, or he got the suit, you know, when he was in the spaceship from his dad and stuff
right.
like that. But he obviously learned how to fight somehow, to fight Zod. But like, the way I look at it is like, he's only been Superman for one day, but he's been on Earth for all this time. So he has already gained all this power that Zod and the other Kryptonians haven't soaked in yet. Like, remember, they keep showing Zod, and he's like he's actually seeing through his own skin, like freaking out from the powers of our sun, going from the origins of Superman and whatnot. But I'm just saying, it's like, he's fighting Zod, and he's only been Superman for one or two days, and he's trying to contain this super villain, and of course they're flying through buildings, and it's like he can't save everybody
right.
because of this version of Superman. It's not the version where he's like, you know, he's saving everybody. He did save a bunch of people in that movie, but I look at it that way. It's like if Zod said, it's either you or me.
Is Superman savable? Because now they're saying that because Man of Steel, and they already had this in plan, but they had to pair him with Batman. They had to put him with Justice League. He's not by himself for a while.
No, you know what happened is basically it was just like, it's just Superman has already been saved by doing Man of Steel. It was a big hit. They were going to do Man of Steel 2. And it's just because Zack Snyder, just in a recent interview, said, what if they were delivering a box of kryptonite to Bruce Wayne's manor? And that just opened up a can of worms, which actually was not a bad can of worms because it made what we're about to see happen, which is what almost every single superhero fan has always wanted to see, is Batman and Superman on the screen together.
Right.
And that's happening.
And the closest you got up until this point was when they put out the animated version of Dark Knight.
The Dark Knight Returns,
which was amazing.
I
love it. And they kept it in 1985.
So
President
perfect.
Reagan was there.
Jay Oliva is the director on that. He did a fantastic job because most of the DC animated movies have a little bit of a cheap budget too. Like,
right.
As an animation director, it bugs me when I see bad animation. So it's like, at the very least, The Dark Knight Returns was really well executed. And he did a great job of like taking the smaller budget that they had and being able to be true, and they were able to break it into two movies, so I'm sure that helped them get a little bit more money. But it was like, it was really true and faithful to Frank Miller's comic book, and I loved it. And the additions, especially with him fighting Superman at the end, some of the
right.
additions of them going into the bigger battle that they made was great. So can Superman be saved? I think he is saved. Man of Steel 2 is going to come out. I think Batman v Superman is going to expand on the cinematic universe that DC established with Man of Steel. And we're going to get all these other brand new characters, but told in that universe. And I think I'm excited. It's a different universe than Marvel's universe.
Well, check out the movie, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened. Jon Schnepp, Holly Payne, thank you so much. It's out on video on demand right now, so go and there's
you
no excuse.
You can find it at www.tdoslwh.com, and you can find us on Twitter, TDOSLWH. TDOSLWH is an anagram for The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, so just use every letter in the title of the movie.
Yeah, and if you go, it's you're truly supporting independent filmmakers. We made this through crowdfunding. We're trying to just recoup the money that we've actually spent. We're in debt. We owe people money. So if you're helping, go to www.tdoslwh.com, buy the Blu-ray or buy the Super Pack Digital Combo, where you get 10 hours of additional material. If you like the movie, you're going to love this other 10 hours. It's just extended and expanded sequences, other people that we interviewed, different stuff. So it's just all based on the same stuff, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened.
Perfect. Thank you guys so much for your time. I appreciate it. Enjoy Comic-Con.
Right on.